All right. Discussion on Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin, chapters 8, 9, and 10. Before we get into these three chapters and discussing the contents of these chapters, just wanted to talk a little bit about Harriet Beecher Stowe as an author. You know, I'm not really a big fan of Harriet Beecher Stowe and her writing style. The argument on, you know, of abolition and the end of slavery, that's a good moral argument. It's hard to disagree with that, you know, any moral human being. But as her writing style, I want to kind of look at it, and I didn't want to offer a couple of criticisms that I have as a personal reader of it. What do you think of Harriet Beecher Stowe? I know this is the first time you've read Uncle Tom's Cabin. This is a reread for me. But, I mean, what do you, how do you feel about her as an author?
Well, on some parts, I can't understand what the characters are saying, so that gave me trouble reading.
So because of the broken language in some of the characters, I think a lot of the slaves and a lot of the poor whites, when she's writing in character dialogue, it's chopped and broken. And that, I think, kind of was done on purpose to reflect the low levels of formal education that were in that time period amongst lower economic poor whites. And, of course, the slaves were forbidden to be educated. So, I mean, that is one thing. Two of the things that kind of irritate me about Stowe and her writing is one is she, instead of just telling the narrative and letting the reader be intelligent enough to see the story unfold and see the wrongs of slavery, she's consistently coming in, you know, either after a scene or in the middle of a scene and presenting her argument from, you know, trying to plead with the Christian voter or you know, sympathize with the mothers, because these are political votes, and during that time period there was a lot of political hot activity. The end of slavery, you know, the Missouri Compromise, and these issues, you know, it was all about voting power. So she was definitely trying to reach her arguments to the reading population and the voting population on this topic. And even more, she's very soft-gloved when it comes to a lot of her white characters. Like, they're generally good Christians caught in a wrong system. So, and it goes back to the political influence that this book was trying to have in the day, in the last days of slavery, was that she didn't want to come out and really blast, you know, the white landowning population too heavily, because it would have kind of pushed them from the way they needed them to vote to end slavery, you know, the way I look at it. Another thing is, I really don't think Harriet Beecher Stowe, as a Southern white woman, can properly capture the sentiments of a slave during those times. She tries to. She almost paints them like children, but I don't think she understood the soul of a slave as much as she thought she did. And I don't think she understood the heart and soul of a man either, breaking down the genders. So, you know, I didn't think her male characters or her slave characters were authentic characters. I think they were created in her mindset and with a political reason behind those characters. I don't think she can properly, as a Southern white woman during that period of time, I don't think she could reflect the true sentiments and mindset and thinking process of, one, a slave, to a landowning white male. So those are my thoughts on, you got anything else on her as an author? Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to go ahead and get into chapter 8 of Uncle Tom's Cabin. You can go ahead and summarize.
Okay, on chapter 8 is when Mr. Haley meets a couple of his friends who isn't a slave catcher?
They were not so much friends as they were business associates in the slave selling game and the slave capturing game.
And, they had an discussion of Eliza and Harry, and Marks, who is one of his associates, as you said, it's came up with a trade, which is that they get Eliza while Haley gets Harry. So.
Right.
Yeah, and towards the end, Sam tells Mrs. Shelby and Aunt Chloe what happened to Mr. Haley and Eliza.
Okay, and what happened to Eliza?
Eliza jumped across the river.
Okay, she got across the Ohio River into the free state of Ohio. It just so happens that after Eliza got across the Ohio River and the slave seller, Mr. Haley, was frustrated that two business associates of his that were slave sellers, slave catchers, actually, trackers, rolled into the town, and that was a man named Tom Loker and his associate named Marks. And the three get together and for drinks, and they're discussing the issue, you know, of the escaped slave. And basically, they're having a conversation on women slaves and how they react to having their young children sold from them. And, it, you know, some of the things that are said during that discussion are of interest. And one was, I believe it was Marks. Actually, it was Loker. He states that the first thing he does when he buys a female slave is what?
He beats a woman up.
He takes his fist to her face. And then, you know, if she's got a youngin', he tells her, he's like, this youngin's mine, not yours, and I'm going to sell it the first chance I get. So he heavy hands them and very physically abusive of the mother's female slaves that he gets his hands on. But anyway, like she said, they make a deal that Loker and Marks will track Eliza and her son, recapture them, and the deal goes down that they'll return Harry to the slave seller, Mr. Haley, and then they're going to keep Eliza and take her to New Orleans and make the profit off of her. So the deal struck in this chapter, and then the rest of the chapter goes back to Sam the slave going back to the Shelby's plantation and telling Mrs. Shelby and Mr. Shelby that, yes, Eliza escaped, and Mr. Haley kind of looked like a fool. And so he was generally welcomed pretty happily by the Shelbys, and then he was sent down to Aunt Chloe's kitchen where he got a big meal and got to gather all the other slave hands around and tell them this big story about how he was the hero, and he talks quite frequently on principles. And that's how that chapter pretty much wraps up. Did you have questions on chapter 8?
Yeah, I only have one question, is that why would Tom abuse women if other traders would probably want them?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. I mean, once again, we're talking about a character created by, you know, Harriet Beecher Stowe. And there, you know, if that's your property and you're going to make profit off of it, you certainly don't want to smash their face in. I mean, that's would be common business sense. But at the same time, they were drinking. He could have just been talking out a drink, too. I mean, regardless, the slave trade, the domestic slave trade in America was very real. There were physical abuses, even though from a business perspective, probably not too many because these human beings were regarded as property. But they were also rapes going on. The female slaves were often raped. So, I mean, that's something of a horror in itself. But there's no solid answer on that question. But good critical thought question. All right, so we'll move to chapter 9, and I'll give the summary for chapter 9. Chapter 9 is the first time that the Fugitive Slave Act is brought into the conversation or the book. And it starts out in the home of a senator, Senator Byrd from Ohio, and it didn't really clarify whether he was a state senator or a U.S. senator, but I'm thinking he was probably a state senator, but he could have been a U.S. senator. But anyway, we're starting to look at the legislation that came out of the Missouri Compromise of 1820, and then with the issues going on in Kansas, we were having more compromise in legislation, national legislation. And one of the big issues that were slaves were escaping from the South up into the northern free states, and there was political pressure coming from the southern slave states and the two-party political system in the United States to put some kind of laws into effect where, you know, if an escaped slave made it into the free states, that you couldn't abet them or give them things or help them go further north. You were supposed to return them, report them, and send them back to the South. So it became federal law. And when I was researching a little bit on the laws that were referenced to this chapter, I came across an Ohio case, and I guess Ohio had a pretty strong wave of abolitionist activity, because after the Federal Slave Act, there was an event in Ohio called the Oberlin-Wellington Rescue Case of 1858. And Oberlin and Wellington were two areas in Ohio, and there was a escaped slave in those areas that a federal marshal recaptured and was about to take back south. And many of the people of these two communities helped that slave re-escape. And 37 people were indicted for, you know, on grounds of the Fugitive Slave Law, of 1850. They were indicted for that. And I don't know, I think only two of them did hard time, but I thought that was an interesting historical fact. But anyway, back to chapter 9, the Senator Byrd, went home. He'd been traveling, been doing legislation, went home to spend an evening with his wife and children. And it just so happens that his wife was a character created by Stowe that was Christian and very supportive of helping the runaway slaves. She was against the Fugitive Slave Law. And so they had a big, long discussion about, you know, whether it was right or wrong. And, of course, the wife, the female mother, was against the law. And, of course, the senator was like, you don't understand politics. You know, I support it. And then as soon as they get done having this argument, the hands bring in Eliza and Harry, who are almost frostbitten blue from the cold, and they're just in a deplorable state and just of misery. And so, you know, here Senator Byrd has to make a choice, and the choice he makes is to, you know, they already had a reputation of being a feeling company, and so they brought in Harry and Eliza and let them stay for a while, and then even Senator Byrd helped them get to a safe house. So that's the summary for chapter 9. What was your questions or notes on that chapter?
Some of my questions are, why did Eliza trust them so easily?
Well, I think she was kind of, you know, as the narrative goes, she was probably disorientated. She didn't know anybody in Ohio. She was a runaway slave, and she was probably suffering from hypothermia. And once the probably the domestic slaves around this town were out running errands, they probably guided them to this house of the Senator Byrd, who was known for kind of being good Christian helpers of runaway slaves in this free state.
Also, why did Mr. Byrd give us money if he was in support of not giving runaway slaves?
Well, I think the way that Harriet Beecher Stowe tried to portray Senator Byrd as a character was that he was going along with the system. He was casting the votes, you know, just like they do in Washington today. They might not believe in something, but to keep their political longevity and to keep lining their pockets, they're going to vote, you know, yes, let's give $3 billion to Israel, even though they're wiping out, you know, hundreds of civilian women and children. But, you know, he clearly had some kind of moral character, because he did take them in. He drove the wagon himself in the muddy weather and took them out to the safe house, to where the honest John Van, what was his name? John Van Trump, who used to be a Kentucky landowner, a Kentucky slave owner, had freed his slaves supposedly and bought land up in Ohio, and he would house escaped slaves up there. So the senator did take Eliza and Harry up to this man and turn him over. And this guy, Honest John Van Trump, apparently he was all about his sons and his guns, because he made several references that if the slave catchers come up there, that they'd be ready for him whenever, you know, with the guns and his six sons. So Senator Byrd gave that man the money to give to her for if she continued her trip further north. And we've read the ideal was to get to Canada in the Elgin settlement. And we remember that book that we read. What was that book? With the Canadians free settlement, where the slaves had went up to Elgin.
Isn't that
It's named after your little brother.
Elijah Buxton.
Yep, Elijah Buxton. Very good book. We recommend that anybody would read that, adults or, you know, middle school students. So any other questions on that chapter?
No.
Any other notes or anything on that? I think the most important thing about chapter 9 is you see the argument of the Fugitive Slave Act, and you start seeing the legislation, you know, toward the North and South. So we'll move on to chapter 10, and we'll let you go ahead and summarize on that.
In chapter 10, Aunt Chloe and Uncle Tom gets to in one of their arguments about Mr. Shelby selling Tom and how it was unfair and unchristian of them.
Basically, it's Tom's last breakfast before he gets picked up by Mr. Haley. So Aunt Chloe's made a real big breakfast for him and the children. And she's, once again, we've seen the argument before in prior chapters, where she's kind of like blasting Mr. Shelby for selling her husband. And then Tom, with his Christian norms and values, is telling her, hey, don't talk that way. You know, it's better me than everybody. It's better me than you or the children. And Tom really does clutch onto that Christian ideology. He says that, you know, even though the slaves fear the South and they know the climate down there is much heavier and that they kill slaves on a regular basis, working them to death, that, you know, Tom says in the chapter, you know, the same God here is going to be the same God down there. So they have their last breakfast, and who shows up at the breakfast? And it's just another example. Go ahead.
Master George shows up and tells George that Tom that they're planning to break him out once they get the money.
Well, actually, Master George, who is Mr. Shelby's son, catches up with Mr. Haley and Uncle Tom when they're on the road already at the blacksmith shop to say goodbye, and says that I'm gonna buy you back. But during breakfast, who shows up in tears? Mrs. Shelby, talking about, we're gonna buy you back as soon as we can. And here we have Harriet Beecher Stowe creating these good white characters, these good moral white characters that, you know, you gotta question whether it's a reality or not, because they're all about having the big house and the comforts of life based off the enslavement of human beings. So, you know, cry those crocodile tears if you want. Nobody's making you not sign those free papers and take a cut in lifestyle. That's my view on it. And I think that Harriet Beecher Stowe, as an author, certainly soft gloves the white characters to an extent in here. And I think that's because that they were going to be the readers of this book, and she was trying to influence the abolitionist vote with these landowning voters. So that's why she probably, either she didn't understand it, or she tried to soft glove it so that these voters wouldn't see too much ugliness in themselves and would kind of change their ways. But so Mrs. Shelby shows up. She's crying. She's all sad. Mr. Shelby, as promised, he took off out of there and went and stayed with a friend for a couple of days because he couldn't face Tom. But yet Tom still, he harbored no ill will toward Mr. Shelby. His mindset was that Mr. Shelby couldn't help it, that white people didn't have to think about things like that, so it wasn't their fault that they automatically were raised to not think about consequences. So it's kind of a funny ideology, you know, in my opinion, but at the same time, it's 2014, looking back at, you know, you're talking 1850s. So what else in that chapter?
While they were driving towards, I guess, their house or plantation, Uncle Tom was tied down to the chariot, but why?
Yeah, and that's something that, you know, all the slaves had came out to see Tom off, and Mr. Haley put the fetters on him, put the shackles on his ankles, the iron handcuffs on the feet. And so that was kind of like adding insult to injury, because, you know, Tom had that reputation around the region of being top Christian, top Christian slave, top obedient, loyal slave. And, you know, to insinuate that he was going to run or something like that was kind of an insult. And Aunt Chloe didn't take it very well. But Tom took it with dignity. And then, you know, they went down, and Mr. Haley had every intention of getting wrist arm shackles for him, too. And that was when Mr. Shelby's son, Master George, caught up with him and said his goodbye to Uncle Tom, gave him a dollar. But, you know, and Master George is talking all this trash to Mr. Haley, talking about how bad it is to sell humans and sell slaves. And, you know, Mr. Haley says to Master George, he says, you know, as long as your grandfolks you don't want to buy men and women. I'm as good as you are, or I'm as good as they are for selling them. You know what I'm saying? So he's like, your parents are doing it, basically. So I'm just as good as they are. And that's what he said to Master George. And that's kind of how the chapter ended. And we'll see where Tom goes. Basically, what Harriet Beecher Stowe does in this book is she uses Tom as the main character to move around where she can exploit and kind of narrative the certain areas and arguments of slavery. So we will continue to read this and discuss it chapter by chapter. Any final thoughts from you on this?
I don't believe so.
She doesn't believe so, so I don't have any final thoughts either. Short video, down to the point, informal. Education is power. I'm out.